Would you let them know that it's saying Wanda Lewis? It's not saying.
The blackness, keep on.
Back to the Wanda Lewis Show. Still just love that song, Be Optimistic. You can win as long as you keep your head to the sky. Wow, happy holidays to you. It's what, Merry Christmas, Happy Hanukkah. So many ways that we give honor and praise to this season, this God that we all serve in so many different ways. There was a song I heard as a child. It's called One God, millions of ways we all say his name. So with that being said, I want to wish you love. Love is a very many splendid thing, as they say. It's used so often in so many ways, but truly, I'm asking you to love yourself and to love your neighbor. We've got some tumultuous times we're facing right now, so much unrest politically, and in another way. So just let's embrace each other. I watched the Charlie Brown Christmas the other day. I'm going back to my days of youth, and certainly it just seems that Linus had it right, you know, that angel came and said a child was born. So yes, we all want to get our bling this Christmas. We all want to, you know, go on trips and enjoy and celebrate and give gifts. But that gift, that most special gift, was the gift of Jesus Christ. I'm reflecting on Wanda's wisdom. I'm so honored that I get a chance to bring some of my soul to you in this setting. When we look inside of ourselves, so many of us do compete. We want to be the best. We're taught, you know, it's all about me, you know. But right now in this time of the season, I want you to realize that you are successful because of the way you treat people. We are successful when we turn the other cheek. We're successful when we look inside and say, I've done my very best. I'm again reminiscing and going back and reflecting on my days in high school at Morgan Park High School here in Chicago. I was honored to have been blessed with the title Most Likely to Succeed. What really does that mean when you're 18 years old and life is wonderful, there's been no adversity? But I want to tell you, when I was working at Xerox Corporation, I looked at the desk of one of the most successful sales reps, and I said, that is the secret to life. And what it was a piece of prose written by Ralph Waldo Emerson, who was a Presbyterian minister many years ago. And what Ralph said, success is this. Success is to laugh often and much, to win the respect of intelligent people, to earn the appreciation of honest critics, to win the affection of children, and to endure the betrayal of false friends, to appreciate beauty, to leave the world a bit better, either by a healthy child, a garden patch, or a redeemed social condition. To know that even one life has breathed easier because you have lived, this is to have succeeded. Thank you. We'll be right back. Good evening, and welcome to the Wanda Lewis Show. We're so pleased that you could join us today, and we're exceptionally pleased to have the mayoral candidate for City of Chicago, Bill Doc Walls. Welcome.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here.
Pleasure to have you, sir.
My honor, my pleasure.
Absolutely. We are just thrilled to have a platform where you can help us to get to know you a little better.
Absolutely.
Why are you running for this prestigious office? Who are you and what you bring to the table?
Oh, boy, you start with a whole lot of good questions.
Yes, sir.
Give me an opportunity
it's
to talk
yours.
About who I am and what I do and
yes.
why I do what I do.
It's your
That's
show
fantastic.
For the next.
Yeah, I was born and raised in Chicago. Graduated Horace Mann Elementary, Chicago Vocational High School, Tuskegee University, and IIT Chicago Kent College of Law. I love this city. And I have children and grandchildren. And this city is not serving their interests or serving their needs. You know, there are two Chicagos. There's a world-class Chicago, and there's an underclass Chicago. And that world-class Chicago is beautiful, safe, tourist-friendly, robust, is full of resources and unlimited opportunities for Rahm Emanuel and the other one percenters. Those people who have money, riches, connections, and clout. But for the average person, Chicago is a war zone. You're either dodging potholes if you're driving, or you're dodging bullets if you're on your way to school.
Wow.
And we want to change that. We want to turn that around. I mean, the underclass Chicago has decaying neighborhoods, unsafe streets, trigger-happy police officers, inferior city services, no jobs, no schools, no parks, no economic development, slumlords, flooded basements, gas and electricity shutoffs, food deserts. The people in those communities are just being pushed out of Chicago. So that's why I'm running for mayor, to turn that around, because I care. I know that Chicago has the resources to make it better for everybody. But we don't have a mayor who cares enough to make it better for everybody.
Okay, well, it sounds like you are the man for the job. What would you say is going to be your greatest challenge and your first level of, let's say, change that you'd like to implement when you are elected?
First thing we have to do is create jobs. Mm-hmm. That's critical and important. You know, a lot of these young guys in our community, particularly in the black community, young men, 97% are unemployed. They have no jobs, they're not in school, they have nothing to look forward to. We've shut them out of our parks, our schools, our libraries, nowhere to go. They hang around on the street corners and on the stoop, talking to their peers and people who understand their pain. And a lot of them are young fathers who can't even go see about their children because they don't have money for Enfamil or for diapers.
Yes.
So they're in pain. We want to get them employed. It doesn't matter if they have an X on their back or if they have no education, there's a place for them in this city. And we want to get them working. So we have programs to do just that.
Okay, what are some of those programs?
Well, one is the use of capital improvement programs. We have a capital improvement program in Chicago, a $7.9 billion spending program. And that program has four areas of concentration: economic development, transportation, education, and infrastructure improvement.
Right.
Typically, the mayor of the city of Chicago, who can spend that money at his discretion, uses it for for infrastructure improvement only.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to turn that around.
Okay.
We're going to make sure we start seeding small businesses in our community so they can hire the people who live in the neighborhoods.
Excellent.
Excuse me.
No, that's fine. Okay, great. So, okay, jobs first. What are your thoughts as far as the current administration? If you could give some advice today to Mayor Emanuel, where would you tell him to concentrate his efforts? Now, I know that's a tricky question. Obviously, there'll be some debates coming, but in the fact that you are a person with so much history, you were working with Mayor Washington in the past. Mm-hmm. You were advising many folks. What do you think is the most glaring area of, let's say, I won't say what he's omitting, but where are we lacking that leadership in his campaign?
Lack of care,
okay.
Lack of concern, lack of commitment to all of Chicago. As I said, there are two Chicagos. Mm-hmm. We have to turn Chicago into one world-class city where everybody feels safe, feels like they can go out and spend money in their neighborhood, mm-hmm. get a fair return for their dollar,
yes.
and be treated like human beings. It's not happening in Chicago. The next thing we have to do is make Chicago safe. Mm-hmm. We have to have irreproachable public safety services, not just in terms of the policies, practices, procedures, equipment, training, deployment, response time, and overall performance, but also in terms of making certain the entire police and fire department, rank, file, and command, is proportionately reflective of the city's population.
Excellent.
Be you black, white, Latino, and Asian, you ought to have an opportunity to get a job as a police officer or a fireman or a paramedic in Chicago. Everybody ought to be treated equally. That's not happening. We're going to make certain that it does. We also have to have new equipment. We have to have body cams and yes. synchronize them with the dashboard cams.
Okay. Yes.
So that we can record all occurrences and all incidents and all arrests, so that people are then judged fairly, right. not simply based upon what a police officer said happened or didn't happen.
Okay, excellent, excellent. So accountability.
Yeah, absolutely.
I don't know if we want to endeavor in what's going on in New York City or Ferguson, Missouri, but this is a problem, this problem of crime, this problem of inequity and how individuals are being policed. How would you, again with the body cams and such, but how would you address those bigger issues on a national platform if in fact you did have a chance to govern over the city of Chicago?
I'd be remiss if I didn't mention someone whom I highly respect and whom I watch battle for dignity, and that's Dr. Walden, who will be a guest on your show.
Yes.
Who went through injustice mm-hmm. for a long period of time. It happens to so many people. I think he was a young man snatched off the bus and convicted of a crime that he never committed. I may have the facts slightly wrong, but I know that's the tenor of the circumstance.
Yes.
And people hurt for a lifetime under those kinds of circumstances. So John Birch tortured people and made them confess to crimes that they did not commit. And many of those young people ended up on death row and, you know, just lives ruined. And people say, oh, well, it's just, you know, one life, get over it. No, but when it happens to you, mm-hmm. you want the whole world to stop and pay attention. So we have to feel the pain of these mothers and fathers who are losing these young children
yes.
to senseless violence. It's one thing to be victimized by someone who is not paramilitary.
Okay.
Someone who's not trained, someone yes. who is desperate or destitute. It's a whole nother thing to be victimized by a law enforcement officer who's sworn to serve and protect.
Yes.
Under my administration, we will not tolerate abuse of people or abuse of power.
Amen.
We will make certain that our police department serves and protects the people of the city of Chicago and counsels them when necessary. It's a shame what happened to Trayvon Martin.
Yes.
They lowered the bar. They said that Zimmerman, who wasn't even a police officer, had the right to kill Trayvon Martin, a little guy with just Skittles in his hand. And then you had Mark Brown in the middle of the street, gunned down like a dog. Then you had in New York.
Mr. Gardner.
Mm-hmm. Francis Gardner in New York, choked out by a police officer despite the fact that he pleaded, I can't breathe, I can't breathe, I can't breathe. Black life has to matter.
It does.
To people.
Mm-hmm.
And until black life begins to matter to people, we're going to continue to see these types of incidents over and over and over again. So we will not tolerate that. And under the Washington administration, and I did serve as a top assistant to Harold Washington,
yes.
traveled with him locally, nationally, and internationally. Police brutality went down quickly because
yes.
they knew that that mayor was not going to tolerate police abuse of authority, and I will not tolerate that. So police officers will not get support from me. Our independent police review authority will actually review with the intent of making certain that police officers did what they did. And that's where that body cam and that dashboard cam come in, because now everything that happens is fully recorded.
Very good, very good. Speaking of cameras, I saw you at a community mayoral event a couple of weeks ago, and I asked a question about the cameras, the red light cameras, the parking situation with our meters, and of course, maybe elongated yellow lights purported to be in our communities. I understand the city has to raise money. We understand that there are bills to be paid. But do you find there is a disparity as far as where these cameras are strategically located in our communities? I know that that's come up in the past.
Yeah, first of all, you cannot balance a budget based on fines, fees, and assessments, and you cannot balance a budget on the backs of the poor and think that you're going to have a livable city.
Yes.
You can't do that. You have to have other ways of cutting expenses, and we have some major ways to do just that. But let's go back to the red light cameras, the blue light cameras, right, the speed zone cameras, those pay-to-park meters in our parks and near the beaches, particularly in black neighborhoods. They stop people from being able to go out and enjoy the natural landscape and the natural resources that Chicago boasts about. So they are not a part of this city, because if you can't afford to go and park, you can't take your child to go kick a ball or to toss a football. We want to change that. We want to make certain that everybody can enjoy this one Chicago. We want to make it affordable for all people. And we can make it affordable for all people without bankrupting the city. We want a city of prosperity.
There you go.
Not a city of austerity. I heard Jesus Garcia, one of my opponents, say that we should get ready for bitter medicine and shared sacrifices. Well, I've got news for you. Black Chicagoans have already tasted that bitter medicine, and they've already made more than enough sacrifices. And city employees have already sacrificed to the nth degree. It's time now to build a smart Chicago, a smart economy that guarantees every Chicago resident a better quality of life, more spending on education, rehabilitation and skill development, and a whole lot less spending on incarceration. We have to build our communities, our parks, our schools, our libraries. Rahm Emanuel closed 50 schools all at once. The worst closure of schools in the history of any city in this nation. He should have never done that. I don't care if you tell me that they were underperforming and under-enrolled. Enrollment may have been down, but that's temporary. So what you do is, you take those facilities and you retain them as education first facilities. But you put in a police substation. You put in a Department of Human Services. You put in a regional CPS office. You put in a WIC office. You put in mental therapy training for those children who are required to have that.
Excellent.
Now it's one-stop shopping and protection for families and children.
Very good.
And you can then label those as sustainable buildings because they're paid for by multiple entities who have the money to spend. So now you retain those as neighborhood schools. And the reason that's so important is because when a child is made to transfer from one school to another, they lose 6 months of education. They have to also go in and re-indoctrinate themselves and make new friends. They have to go to school across gang lines. And oftentimes they drop out because they'd rather live than get an education under those circumstances. Parents have to readjust their schedules. It is an unwholesome, unhealthy thing, and you don't do it at any expense. And it's also costing us $1.8 million a year just to heat those schools and light those schools. I know Ernestine Standberry talks about the fact that her sister in Indianapolis lives in a building that was a school building but is now made an apartment building. That's not the answer for us. We want to reopen those schools.
Yes, yes, education is key. You touched on the family. I know that one of your major points on your platform is that you want to make sure that Bibles and religion are reintroduced in the schools?
Not religion.
Okay.
I want to be real clear.
Okay.
The Constitution says it's legal to teach the Bible in school as part of the curriculum.
Okay.
The Supreme Court has confirmed it is legal to teach the Bible as part of the curriculum in school. It's done in school districts all across this country, public school districts, legally. Mm-hmm. What we want to do is teach the Bible as part of the curriculum in Chicago public schools, just like you teach Greek hieroglyphics.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
I'm sorry, Egyptian hieroglyphics.
Oh, okay. Yes.
And about Greek gods, Greek mythology.
Okay, yes.
So you also teach the Bible, because the Bible is the foundation of Western civilization, and people need to know why our dollar says, "In God we trust."
Exactly.
And when they're in classrooms in college all across this country, sitting next to students coming from other jurisdictions who learned about the Bible, our students are at a disadvantage.
I see.
We owe them every opportunity to prosper in life, and we shouldn't use our narrow fears and phobias to quash our children's hopes and dreams. We have to teach them more than reading, writing, math, and science. We have to give them everything they need to be full, well-rounded human beings.
Excellent. Oh my goodness. It's been such a pleasure to have you here on my show. I know you have another show to get to. You just left a candidates forum. We'd like to welcome you back.
Thank you.
Would you consider coming back?
Absolutely. Again and again.
Absolutely. Your home, your forum.
Thank you.
Bill Doc Walls, welcome and thank you.
My pleasure.
Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
We appreciate your coming through. Mm-hmm. Well, this has been the Wanda Lewis Show. I hear this song in the background. It's time for a little music. I've written a couple of tunes, as they say. You know, I'm sure we've shared that I was a member of the Sounds of Blackness for 11 years and had a chance to tour the world and see all kinds of folks. But there is what I consider just three basic tenets we all share. There are three basic tenets we share as human beings. One, we all want to love, we want to be loved, and we want to find something we believe in. So this song is Keep Looking Up. I don't know if I'm going to get into any tunes here, am I, Doc Walls?
I don't know.
But let's see. Keep looking up. God will be there for you. And thank you once again. Bye-bye. That's right. Come on. Yeah. All right. Come on. Yeah. I want to tell the gospel and spread the news. Jesus' love is there for you, but it's up to you to choose confusion. Who's all around? Look to Jesus when life gets you down. Keep looking up, he'll be there for you. Keep looking up, he'll always see you through. Keep looking up, he'll never let you down. Keep looking up, yeah, he'll always be around.
my side through every tribulation. He's always been my guide, I know without a doubt. He'll always pull me through. Keep looking up, he'll be there for you. Keep looking up, y'all, he'll always see you through. Keep looking up, he'll never let you down. Keep looking up, yeah, he'll always be around. Keep looking, looking, looking up, looking. Keep looking up, yeah. All right now, keep looking up, he'll be there for you. Keep looking up, yeah, 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 yeah. Keep looking up, he'll be there for you. Keep looking up, yeah. Oh, yeah. All right. Amen.